Let's talk about contingencies. What are they? What do they mean for you as a buyer? Why should you have them in the contract? And what can happen during those contingency periods? Contingencies for the buyer. That's what we're talking about today, and we're starting right now.
I'm Sherri Ann Green with Coldwell Banker. Welcome to my YouTube channel that guides home sellers and home buyers in Washington, D.C. and Northern Virginia.
When you go to buy a house, by the time you put in an offer, you are pretty sure that that is the house you want to live in. You should be really sure, actually, to take the time to write an offer and to take the time to have the seller consider it. However, there could be some things that you want to investigate or that you need to investigate before you close on that home to confirm that it is in great shape and a great investment. Those periods of time that you can write into that contract are called contingency periods. Buyers can have contingencies and sellers can have contingencies too. For this video, I want to talk strictly about the three most common contingencies that a buyer adds to their contract. There certainly can be other things that are important to you as a buyer or things that are important to the seller that they may want to add to a contract. But these three things are the most typical, the most common contingencies that you would probably consider writing into your offer. So let's first start with, what is a contingency? What's a contingency period? It's a big word, and it's one of those words that you learn when you go to buy a house. In simplest terms, a contingency is a period of time added to the contract through a clause or an addendum that gives you time to do due diligence on the home, to negotiate any issues that you find, or to terminate the contract if you find things that cannot be rectified or negotiated. Today, I want to focus on the three most common contingencies that you would likely add to your purchase. The first is a home inspection. And a home inspection contingency period gives you time to bring in a licensed home inspector to look at the house from top to bottom. In a condo, they will simply look at the interior contents of the unit that you are purchasing. If you're buying a home, again, it's top to bottom. So they will look at the roof, the walls, the doors, the windows, the foundation, the crawl space, the attic, the systems, the appliances. All of these things are important for you to know and understand, and also important for you to understand how to maintain. The inspector can give you some great tips during the home inspection, and their multi-page report with photos is a great resource for every homeowner to have. You should keep that report as a reference all the way through your home ownership. Most buyers bring in one home inspector who does a thorough investigation of the whole house. That being said, if you are buying a very unique or special property or a large property, you may want to bring in a variety of specialists. If you suspect water, you may want to bring in a specialist who focuses simply on that. If you are buying a house that may have structural issues, maybe it's a fixer-upper, you may want to also bring in a structural engineer. But let's talk about this from the general overview of a licensed home inspector who looks at everything. They will look at windows and doors and appliances and systems, and they will ensure that all of those things are in working order, that they are safe, and there isn't a major hazard. What a home inspector is not there to do is look at aesthetic and design changes that you just don't like. So if there is something that is simply not to your liking, it doesn't mean that it's an item for the home inspection to be negotiated. Again, we're talking safety, security, proper working order, or something that is hazardous that you would want to negotiate. Now, if a problem was disclosed to you prior to you writing and negotiating that offer, it's likely something that you also can't turn around and negotiate in the home inspection period. You were disclosed the problem and you wrote your offer based on that problem, so negotiating for it again is not always possible. Now, if you find that the problem is larger than one assumed, or there is evidence that it is an urgent issue that needs to be fixed, by all means, that may be something that you can negotiate with the seller. There are times when the two parties cannot come to an agreement and you can terminate your contract, but go into the period of negotiation for your home inspection contingency with a positive attitude that everything can find a proper resolution. Whether it is a credit to you at closing so that you can repair the item later, or whether it is that the seller agrees to repair it before you close on the house. There are various ways you can negotiate anything that you find that needs to be repaired, so make sure you are thinking strategically about how to address those items with the seller so you both can come to a resolution that makes sense. The second contingency I want to talk to you about is the appraisal. And the appraisal is often confused with the home inspection because it's another inspection. The appraiser isn't going to go in and test all the systems and test all the windows and test all the doors. They will make note that those items are in the house. They are not there to inspect the working order of those systems and appliances. The appraisal is something that your lender will order. Think about it this way. The lender is looking to lend you a large sum of money to purchase an asset, to purchase your home. The lender has to confirm that the risk they are assuming by lending you this money is worth their investment. Is the home that they are lending you the money for going to hold its value and going to be worth the amount of money that you have agreed to pay for it? That's what the appraiser is there to look for. The appraiser will compare the home to comparable houses in the neighborhood. They will look at the city economy, the state's economy. They will look at the materials used in the house and the trends in the value of homes. And they will apply a value to the home that you are buying. Now, what if the appraiser gives a value to the house that is lower than what you have agreed to pay for? That's where the negotiation period comes in. During the appraisal negotiation, you will want to stay in very close contact with your lender. Some lenders and some loan programs will allow you to make up the difference in the value that the lender has put on the house and the amount that you have agreed to pay for the house. So if the house is really worth it for you, it may make some sense for you to make up that difference if your lender allows it. Additionally, you can negotiate with the seller to lower that sales price to get it to the value that the lender's appraisal has put on the home. The third option is that you and the seller agree to split the difference in some fashion, whether it's straight down the middle or one pays a little more than the other. The bottom line is this. If your appraisal does come in low, it opens a negotiation period for you and the seller to talk about the purchase price of the house, the value that the appraiser has given it, and how do we come to an agreement that your lender will allow and that you are comfortable with as a buyer so that you can purchase the house. There are cases where you can order a second opinion in an appraisal, and that is something you would want to ask your lender as well. The last contingency I want to talk about is the finance contingency, and that is closely related to the appraisal contingency, because if your appraisal comes in low, you're probably not going to get your financing. You're probably not going to get the loan underwritten unless you can come to an agreement, as we talked about. There are several things that a lender is doing in that underwriting process. They are reviewing you as the buyer to confirm that your risk is still the same as they understand it. They are examining the finances of the condo, co-op, or homeowners association if you are purchasing inside one of those associations, and they are taking into account that appraisal we talked about. So they're looking at the property, the property's management, the association, and they're looking at you, the purchaser, to examine the risk involved with all of those categories to confirm one final time that it isn't risky to lend you the loan, or it's a risk that they are comfortable taking. Now, what could happen during this finance contingency period, besides the appraisal that we've already talked about, what could happen during this financing contingency period that could cause the lender to think the loan is too risky? Here are some examples. You lose your job. Your partner loses their job. You see an extreme cut in pay. The condo association or HOA association is underwater or being sued or doesn't have the proper reserves to maintain and manage a property of that size. All of these items can be red flags to your lender and can cause a problem with underwriting your loan. If something happens related to those and the lender tells you that they cannot finance your loan, your finance contingency period gives you time to find those answers and to get out of the contract if you need to. The finance contingency gives you the ability to cancel the contract based on your lack of ability to get financing. There are lots of other contingencies that you could add as a buyer. Obviously, a seller wants to see as few contingencies as possible on a contract, but there could be some things that are specific to you that you need to add as a buyer, and those are certainly things you'd want to talk through during the purchase process. These are the three most common things and the three that most buyers consider putting into their contract. Are you thinking about buying a house? You need to subscribe to my channel. I have an entire playlist for buyers, and make sure you hit the bell so you don't miss an episode.